A very warm welcome to everyone. Welcome to the course of Remote Sensing and GIS.
So we were seeing, first we started with A, where exactly the solar energy, source of energy is there and solar radiation is falling onto the Earth's surface. We were able to see that some kind of scattering in between interaction happens and it falls on the Earth's surface. When we are talking on Earth's surface, we have picked one small body where the radiation is falling onto that. Now what happens? An interaction happens between the body and the radiation which has fallen. There what will happen? A transmission can take place, an absorption can absorption or transmission can take place, and again a reflection comes back. Whatever the reflection is coming back from the body, that has been captured by your satellite, which is sitting in the space. Once the satellite captures everything, it transfers that whatever the radiation it has collected to the receiver which is sitting in the space, and immediately that sends a signal to the station which is sitting at the ground surface, and it translates into a readable format. Okay, and that we are calling that format as a digital format. Okay, so now once this conversion happens, everything is in digital, it is ready for use. Okay, so when this conversion happens, everything gets stored step by step. It is stacked in one, perfect data. So that what happens is, once again, you come back. So let's say I wanted to do some 20 years climate change. Now, what is happening with the climate through 20 years? What do? I go back to the data. I should check it. So whenever you're trying to store or stack the data, you should do in a proper manner. Okay. After stacking storage of this data, I said you there are two things. One thing is conversion of that data into digital format. When it has happened, some features may be available, some features may not be available or not seen. You should do some kind of analysis and processing. First interpretation comes into picture, next for analysis comes into picture. Once analysis has been done, you need to do or use that information for some kind of project. You need to do apply that data, make use of that data and do some kind of application. So then only the data which is being collected by the satellite is utilized. Okay, so once if that data, whatever we are collecting, it's sitting there only, there is no use, right? So let's go on to the lecture. It's a quick recap of whatever we have discussed in the earlier class. So you can see A, B, C, D, E, F, G. A refers to the solar energy. B, both the B's refer to the travel from the space into the ground surface. What happens in between? Scattering may take place. An interaction happens between the air molecules or whatever is present in the, atmosphere. A reaction happens with the radiation. Okay. C is nothing but the target is sitting at the C. D is your satellite which is there in the space. Okay. We are basically talking about your satellite remote sensing. So D is, it captures that reflected radiation. And after that, it transfers into the receiver. And next to that, it sends the signal onto the ground station. Once it is getting that radiation, it converts into a digital format and it gives into the user. Now, what should the user do? The user need to do some kind of interpretation, analysis, and finally, he need to publish some data so that the data, whatever is collected, has been applied somewhere. Okay, so that's the understanding of your satellite remote sensing. Okay, satellite-based remote sensing. So now let's have a quick understanding about where exactly this remote sensing has been started. Okay, so the next slide. So these all things we were discussing in the last class. So let's move on where exactly the remote sensing has started. Okay, it's not that remote sensing has started recently or very few years back. It has started somewhere in 1800s, as I was discussing in the starting itself. Nowadays, if you see in our India, it is getting developed slowly. But if you see the abroad or the olden technology, it has started very fast in the earlier days in 1850. The first thing which was remotely collected. Okay, so there are two things you should understand here. Olden days, if you see remote collection, remotely sensing a data with a different technology used to happen. They used to use a camera. You can see in this first picture where the person is trying to sit in this parachute balloon. Okay, parachute and trying to click a picture here. Okay, what is he using here? He is using a camera. Okay, so basically whatever the camera we click sitting on the ground surface, the same camera has been taken to a very high altitude and from there it is trying to capture. The next two images, you can just have a look on that. they are the output images. They look like similar like a photographs only, but they are captured at a very high altitude. Okay, so this, if you see 1858, the first aerial photograph from a hot air balloon. Okay, so remotely sensing the data using a camera here, but there is a difference in satellite remote sensing. What is a satellite remote sensing is doing is it has an optical sensor in that, okay, and it scans the area. So as of now, you will not understand if I say scan. Okay, what is scan is nothing but pixel by pixel. Let's say my pixel resolution is, let's say, 50 meters. For every 50 meters, it is going to click a picture. Okay, so that's what is called as scanning. So when we will detailly discuss about the scanners, sensors, you will understand. But as of now, you should understand one difference is, olden days they used to use a camera. You know what's a camera? It has a lens in that, right? But the recent technology, what the satellites use is a sensor. And what does it do? It does a scanning. What does this camera do? It just takes a snapshot. Similar to your mobile phone, if you just click, what happens? A picture comes. That's the olden technology. Recent updated satellite remote sensing is scanning the area. Okay, so you can see after that in 1858, after 1858, you can see 1903, a PGN mounted camera patented. What does this mean? Here the person is standing and clipping a picture. Here what has happened? The PGN was being mounted with a camera at the bottom and it's taking the picture. Okay, next, if you see 1914 to 1945, what has happened? Plane mounted cameras. So the aeroplanes or the airplanes, whatever are moving in the in the sky are being fixed with the camera so that they will capture at different places. Okay, so that's the technology. Next, if you see in 1947, if you see first space based photo. What is this space based photo means? And sensor has been used there. Till 47, it was only the kind of lens has been used, camera has been used to clip a picture. But in 1947, if you see a space based, a photo has been clicked and you can visualize how the picture actually will look like. Okay, next to that, if you see 1972, a launch of Landsat 1. What is this Landsat 1 means? It's the Land Satellite 1, which is the name of the satellite, when it is launched in July 23rd, 1972. Okay, this is the Indian satellite. So why I have picked only some names is to make you understand only the Indian satellites. Okay, earlier to this also you have so many satellites. But specifically talking, we are talking about Indian satellites. So in 1972, if you can see, Landsat 1 has been launched. Okay, and 1986, you can see Spot French Earth Observation Satellite, which is 10 meters and 20 meters. So you might be wondering, what is this 10? What is this 20? Okay, it's called as resolution. The picture in which you are able to visualize, or you can simply say that the distance between the two objects, if it is 10 meters, these two objects will be clearly visible on the image. Let's say I have two trees. Okay, there is one tree, there is the other tree. The distance between these two trees, let's say 10 meters or let's say 5 meters. So if I say 5 meters and my satellite has a resolution of 10 meters, these two objects will be seen as a single object because the distance between those two is 5 meters. If the distance between these two trees is 15 meters, let's say, these two trees will be clearly visible because my satellite has a resolution of 10 meters. Okay, so that's what is called as 10 meter or 20 meter spatial resolution. What is these resolutions? We will detailly understand. Okay, as of now, a quick review. Okay, so you can see 1947, 1972, 1986. Go on, if you see the technology is increasing, bands are increasing. So much of resolution change has happened. Now, if you see 0.5 meter resolution satellite images also we have, which are not actually freely available. You can purchase them also. Next to that, you can see there are so many satellites, a global satellite observation system. If you can have a look over here, I don't know whether it is visible to you or not. I have zoomed it. You can see this is our Earth surface. On this, you have so many satellites just revolving around them. So here you can see some China satellites are there. There are American satellites. You can even see our Indian satellites are there in SAT. Okay, this Meteosat is nothing but for meteorological purpose. They use actually those satellites. They are Russian satellites. The other one, if you see, Spot. Okay, so the NOAA, which is a USA satellite. There are so many satellites which are actually going on around the Earth's surface. You can see from 1970 to 1980, there are rapid advances in digital image processing. So what has happened is, through time, when the satellites are getting launched, there's a huge data. If you can see, at an incident, any small part of the Earth's surface is being captured by n number of satellites. So now you should understand how globalization, or how globally the data is available. Okay, single data or single area. Let's say I wanted to study about the Arjuketi campus. Okay, so that Arjuketi campus data has been captured by so many number of satellites. So I can compare each satellite data, comparison between different data sets can be done. I'll take one Indian satellite, I will take one Russian satellite. I will just wanted to compare how these two satellites are doing, whether the data is good or not. I can do so many kinds of analysis. Okay, you should understand that it's a global data. It's not that only one satellite captures a small area. It's a global. No, so many satellites are revolving. They capture each and every data. Okay, you can see from 1980s what has happened. Hyperspectral. Hyperspectral is nothing but the source of energy is your solar energy. Solar energy is nothing but your electromagnetic spectrum. Electromagnetic spectrum has so many ranges in that. Gamma ray is there, X-ray is there, visible region is there, microwave region, so many regions are there in between. Hyperspectral is the satellite which covers all the regions. There are so many wavelength ranges can be covered by those satellites. So that's called as a hyperspectral sensor. Okay, we will understand them in detail. It's just an overview of the remote sensing technology. Okay, in 1990s, you can see global remote sensing systems. Global, just now I said you, a small part of the Earth's surface is being captured by so many satellites. You can compare them. You can make use of the global data which is available. So that's how this remote sensing technology has been developed. Okay, so now let's have a look on our Indian satellites. I brought some Indian satellites to make you understand. So you can see Landsat missions imaging the Earth since 1972. Okay, since 1972, I was just showing you Landsat 1 satellite, which has been launched in 1972. Thereafter, there are so many other Landsats which has come into picture. That's the reason it is given 1, 2, 3, so on. Okay, so now you can visualize how a remote sensing image looks like. Okay, I don't know whether you're able to see something or not. So you can see 1972, there's a Landsat 1, 1980, Landsat 2, 2005, Landsat 5, so on. You have the dates at the bottom. You can see this is a typical satellite image. So I hope everyone knows about a Google Map or a Google Earth software, or simply you will be watching the Google Map. Similarly, your satellite image also looks. But what is the difference is, depending upon the resolution of that satellite, whatever we are seeing, the clarity actually varies. Similarly, like your mobile phone. If you have a good megapixel, obviously your picture, whatever you capture, has a good resolution. In the same way, the satellite also has a good resolution, the picture also will have some clarity. That's only the beauty. Okay, so now you can see, we will see the features here. So you can see Landsat 1 in July 1972, okay, Landsat 2 in 1975, Landsat 3 1978. So now you can imagine 1972, 1975 and 1978. Okay, you can see there's a 3 years gap between each satellite. Okay, and if you can see, there is an overlap here. You can observe the colors over here. First, Landsat 1 has a blue color here. Next to that, you have a first light blue. Okay, next to that, you have a dark blue. In between them, you can see they are overlap. So what does that overlap say you? Why it's an overlap there? If there is no overlap, what would have happened is, let's say Landsat 1, which is trying to collect, has failed in between. Let's imagine. it is non-operational. When some problem has happened and it got stopped something, it didn't collect the data. But due to that overlap, what will happen? Maybe the second satellite is operational and it is collecting the data, right? So there's no loss of data which is happening. If you send one single satellite and you only depend on that one single data, you might fall in a problem. What is happening here? If there is a overlap between the satellites, what is happening? Even though one has got the wrong information or non-operational in picture, what is happening? The second one is giving an additional support. So that's the reason you can see all the time you see an overlap which is happening between the Landsat, between the satellites. Okay, so you can see here, so Landsat 3 at the bottom, if you see, it's the time scale. So from 1970 till the latest 2020, if you see, the latest satellite with our Indian is Landsat 9. Okay, and you can see before that in 2013, you have Landsat 8. Okay, again, you can see there's an overlap here. In between, we have a gap. Okay, and again, Landsat 6 in 1993. Now, Landsat 7 in 1999, and if you can see Landsat 5, it has been for a very long time, 1984 to 2013. So whatever we missed in the earlier satellites or any of the satellite, if I miss some data, I have an additional backup given by the other satellite. That's the kind of launching phenomena. Whenever they are trying to launch, they take a backup of the data, so that they don't miss any of the years, or not even a month data also will be missing there. Okay, a continuity in the data will be achieved there. So this is about your Landsats. So you can see here from 1972 till 2020, if you just have a watch, we have 9 Landsat satellites. Okay, so we will see these characteristics also in the coming slides. So a quick review, you can see here. So remote sensing satellites since 1988, IRS-1, IRS is nothing but Indian resource satellites, IRS-1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, P4, P6, P5, CartoSat, OceanSat, ResourceSat, RISat. So you might be wondering, these are all the names of that. Okay, you can see the launch dates, the vehicle which is being used. So all, I hope everyone knows what is this vehicle. Because you can just have a quick review on what is a satellite, what is a vehicle in that, okay, how that launching will be happen, because that's a different part. If I start saying all those things, no, it will be in a different way. Okay, so if you are interested, you can just browse on that. Okay, so these are the different satellites which we have. Next to that, so now let's go on. I will just talk on some advantages. So what's the remote sensing? We got a quick idea about what is remote sensing, how many satellites are there, and in the coming lectures, we will try to understand in detail what is electromagnetic spectrum. I will make use, how we will make use of this remote sensing data, which is converted into a digital format. During the radiation, which is reaching to the Earth surface, I said so much of scattering happens. So what is the scattering? What are the color changes we generally see? All these things we are going to learn in the earlier coming classes. Okay. Before that, we will talk a small point on why or how your remote sensing is advantageous to us. Okay. So first advantage, if you see synoptic view. Okay. What's meant by synoptic view? Synoptic view is nothing but if you just stand on the ground surface, click a picture. Okay. What is happening? You will cover a very small area. But now when you try to fly over an area, okay, and try to capture the image, what is happening? A large area is getting covered. A larger view is coming into picture. So that's called as synoptic view. Okay, a larger area gets, it will come into picture or capture when you try to fly and capture an image. Okay, and satellite-based remote sensing, capturing also not with a camera, it's done by an optical sensor, okay, which has a scanning device in it, and it scans line by line, okay, pixel by pixel it tries to cover. So that's called a synoptic view. A larger view comes into picture when you try to fly over an area. So now you can see in the functions also, if you see the person who is standing there clicking your picture, no, only that part will be covered. Simply if a drone is flying in that area, what is happening? A larger, globally, the area gets covered. So that's the difference. Okay, synoptic view, global coverage. Just now I have shown you so many satellites which are just revolving around the Earth's surface. And you can see globally they are covered. Each of the satellites has its own data, own resolution. Okay, one part of the Earth's surface, if you just pick, let's say my Basar. If you just pick that area, so many satellites are seeing that Basar area. Even though one satellite misses it or non-operational or some problem, the other one is at the backup. Okay, globally, if you see, a larger area gets covered. Globally, the entire Earth's surface is getting captured by so many satellites, the global data. Okay, next thing, repeatability. Just now I have shown you Landsat satellites, how they are having overlap, right? In overlap areas, what will happen? You even have the Landsat 1 data with you. You even have the Landsat 2 data with you. Now I can just have a comparison whether my two satellites are showing the same pattern of the Earth's surface or not. So let's say I wanted to study how my soil is responding to the radiation. So both the satellites, moreover, the same wavelength range, they should show the same phenomenon. Now I take Landsat 1 data, again I will pick Landsat 2 data. In the same wavelength range, I will see the performance of my soil, whether it is showing the same pattern in first satellite data and second satellite. A repeatability is there in the both the satellites, same data is between capture. So the pattern also should be same, the reflection pattern should be same in both the satellite data. So a repetition has been happening, a comparison study will come into picture. Okay, so that's what is called as repeatability. Next coming, multispectral. Sensors can measure the wavelength energy, measure energy at wavelengths beyond range of human vision. Earlier when I have just introduced a remote sensing to you, I said that eyes are a very good remote sensors, but there is a restriction for our human vision. What is that restriction? We can only visualize the objects in visible region. Apart from visible region, you cannot visualize any of the radiation. But what is happening in the satellite remote sensing? There is an optical sensor which is sitting, which can visualize the radiation beyond visible range. Okay, you have a microwave region, you have an infrared region, you have a gamma region, X-ray. There are so many radiations, wavelength radiation, which are being visualized by the sensors which are sitting in your satellites, where our human vision cannot visualize or sense that radiation. So that's what is called as multispectral. What is meant by multispectral? Spectrum means your wavelength, your electromagnetic spectrum. What is electromagnetic spectrum? It's nothing but you will have so many wavelength ranges in that. All the wavelength ranges are being covered by your satellite. So that's the reason it is multispectral. Okay, multi-resolution. Just now before, when I was showing you spot satellite, your spot satellite here, you can see 1986 the spot satellite. When I was showing you, I have shown you 10 meters and 20 meters. What does the 10 meters and 20 meters say you? 10 meters, it covers the objects or it covers the Earth's surface in two resolutions. One at 10 meter resolution it will cover a 20 meter resolution. Okay, so it's multi-spatial resolution, multi-resolution. Multi-spectral means different wavelengths it can cover the information. Okay, so that's one point. Next to that, near to real time. So what is this near to real time means? You can visualize the data, understand the data, do some analysis which exactly represents your real time. If you just take a surveying instrument, go onto the ground, perform the survey, get the information, do some analysis, how realistic it will be. In the same way, sitting at the place itself, you can visualize this data, do some analysis, do some kind of output, publish it. It's very realistic actually. It represents the ground at a very high accuracy. Okay, but obviously it can only show up to a 90% result. The 10% whatever is left over, it should be ground verified. You need to perform a go to the ground and really see whether there is a tree sitting there or a road sitting there. You need to cross verify. Ground verification always should be done for a remote sensing analysis. Without that ground verification, it's not complete. Okay, when it becomes complete, that 90% analysis, whatever you have done, if a ground verification has been done to that, then only it becomes 100% accurate. Okay, but what I'm trying to say is the remote sensing data, whatever you're trying to utilize in your analysis, that's a real-time data, realistic data. There is nothing unartificial in that. It is more or less a real kind of data, which we actually, if I perform also, I will get the same, more or less the same data. But here my time is saved, my energy, what do you say, my manpower is saved, money is saved. So economic point of view, if you see, realistic is advantageous. Okay, next coming systematic data collection. So when I was showing you this flow chart, I said from D to E, then it is getting transferred. If the data is not collected systematically, what happens? There is so many, every day it captures an image. If I don't maintain a proper data, don't stack them it properly, I don't maintain them, what happens? All the data sits somewhere. When you wanted to just refer, you cannot refer, right? A systematic data collection will be happening in your remote sensing, satellite remote sensing. Okay, a systematic. So whenever you try to search any year's data, so the other day I was saying you, I have done some projects with your super seniors and seniors. So when we were trying to do the analysis, somewhere I got 1950 satellite image also. Okay, so not 1950 topo sheet, 1980 satellite image I got. So if I don't properly maintain that 1980 satellite data, when we are trying to collect or transfer the reflected radiation from the satellite to the ground, if I don't maintain that systematic data collection, what will happen? I cannot retrieve the data once again. Retrieve is nothing but whatever has been stacked. If you wanted to go back and collect that data, you should have a systematic storage purpose. Okay, so that's called as systematic data collection. If systematically the data is collected, whenever you want, you can refer back, you can use that, make utilize of that data utilization. The only solution sometimes for otherwise inaccessible areas. So what does this mean? Sometimes what happens is you will not be able to access that area. So for example, let's say you wanted to go, best example is, let's say the border areas where exactly you have a threat of a enemy coming to you. In such places, you cannot actually go to that area and do a surveying. Rather, what you can do, you can collect the satellite data information, do perform some analysis, give some output results. This is the only solution. So let's say if it's an inaccessible areas and you are not permitted to move in such areas, in such cases, this is only the alternative which you have. You can collect the satellite image, do some analysis and understand that area. Sitting idle, nothing gets in there. But now, in an inaccessible areas, if you make use of this remote sensing, that will be the only solution to you. So that's what is one of the biggest advantage for any inaccessible areas. This is only the solution which is there. Okay, generic data. What is meant by generic data? Generic data is nothing but if once the image is getting captured, let's say today the satellite captures my RGKT campus image, this image can be used for n number of analysis. I can do a flood mapping if a flood is coming here. I can do a earthquake risk map if some earthquake is triggering here. Okay. I can make a landslide map if a landslide land is getting slided here. Okay. I can make a heat wave map if the heat waves are very high here during the summer. Right. If I wanted to just understand how much urbanization has happened in this area, I can do that. If I wanted to know what is the solid waste management, if I just wanted to do where all the solid waste should be dumped, or I can make a map out of that. Okay. If I just wanted to connect all the drainages, I can do that. If I wanted to plan a proper water distribution system, I can do that. For all this analysis, I want only one satellite image, which I am trying to capture today or yesterday, any of the images. So once the satellite is capturing an area, it can be used for n purposes. The purpose, the application, whatever you will use is the user end. Okay, I may be interested in a water distribution system. You may be interested in a sewage system. Right, but both of us can use only single image. Okay, so what I'm trying to focus is, if the satellite captures a single satellite image today, for example, that can be used for multi-purpose. Okay, it's not that once I make use of the satellite, you cannot use it. It's not that. Okay, because the data has been stored, it's been displayed to you in some kind of format, and it's available online. Some are freely available, some are purchased. The freely available option, I can download it, you can download it, the other person also can download it. But you may be utilizing it for some purpose, I may be utilizing it for some purpose. But the same data is getting used for both the purposes. So it's multi-purpose. Once the image is captured, once the satellite has performed its task for today, it can be used for multi-purpose. Okay, so that's what is called as generic data. The meaning of generic data is it has been used n number of times for different purposes. Okay, cost effective. Obviously, if you see, this word may be a little funny to you, cost effective. You might be wondering how it's cost effective, because the satellite launching it itself takes so much of crores of money in that, right? So cost effective part, when someone is trying to come in, let's imagine any of the flood risk map you're trying to do. For example, let's say a flood has been triggered and the entire area has been drawn or inundated. Okay, in such situation, can a person reach there? Right? If you see how actually the government responds, it will be flying and just having a look which area got drowned very much, which area is little safer, how to supply the food, everything, they actually fly and get a visualization. Rather, they don't go in person, because when I try to go in person, what will happen? I may be in a problem. So in such situations, imagine a satellite which is sitting in the space, if it can give a live information to you, a live telecast has been happening of that flood area. So in such cases, if you just imagine, really it's costly. It doesn't mean to us it's really costly, because when it is showing to you a kind of disaster, if it's a visual interpretation is happening in a live condition, it doesn't show us that, okay, it's really costly to us. Because if someone asks you, launching a satellite, is it very cheap? No, it's really costly. But if that satellite is sitting there, giving a live information to me about my flood condition, without me reaching over there, in such scenario, I feel that, okay, really, it's not costly. Because when a man is not able to do something, the satellite is doing to us. It is giving a kind of live information to us to make us understand, okay, what's the situation really in that area. Right? Even though the flying can give you some information, but it cannot exactly show you how much area got drawn, or which is the next area is getting inundated, where my people or my army should reach to which place. If this kind of live information, if a satellite is showing to us, then I don't think that satellite launching is costly. Okay, and when I'm trying to access an inaccessible area where I'm not able to do anything about that area, and if the satellite data is used for accessing that area, then really my satellite data or satellite launching is not really costly. It's cost effective only. When I cannot spend my, even though I spend my money, I cannot reach to that area, then only satellite itself is doing that all work to me. Then it's not really costly. It's cost effective only. Okay, so that's the exact meaning of cost effective. When manpower is not able to do something, money is not able to do something, but still a satellite, if it's giving some information to us, then it's really advantageous to us. It's really cost effective. Right, so that's the meaning of cost effective. So as a whole, if you see the remote sensing advantages, it gives a very larger view to us. If the satellite captures, the focus of that is having a very large area getting covered. It gives a global data. So many satellites capture the entire Earth surface at an instant. If you see, so many hundreds of satellites is seeing our Earth surface. Okay, it's a global data. Repeatability. So many satellites, overlap is there, repeatability is there. Every area is covered by each so many satellites. Okay, comparison study can be done. Multispectral, nothing but so many wavelength ranges. Multi-resolution. Each resolution has been covered by the satellite. realistic data is coming into picture, a systematic data collection happens there. It's the only solution when you are inaccessible in an area. Generic data, I said you, once the image is captured, let's say my Indian satellite didn't capture any image, but my Russian satellite has captured some image. Okay, so then what happens, even this Russian captures or Indian captures, if one image is getting captured, that image can be made use for multi-purpose. Okay, Russian people may use it for some other data, some other purpose. Indian people may use it for some other purpose, but the image is same. Okay, and cost effective. Okay, so that's about your advantages part. Okay, so advantages part, if you have a better understanding, no, inside when I try to go and say you step by step, what is electromagnetic spectrum, what happens in between, so interactions, when we try to understand step by step, no, then these advantages, you will have a more insights. Okay, whatever I have spoken now, multispectral, multi-resolution, these all things you will understand step by step. Okay. So the next slide, we are entering into our depth into the solar radiation. Okay, so as discussed, if you remember the flowchart, we started with A, which is your solar energy, right? Solar energy is nothing but your electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, now we are going to spend so much time on the spectrum, understand each wavelength, and we will see the characteristic properties of some satellites. Okay, how actually these are capturing, all these things we will have a good understanding. So what is an electromagnetic spectrum? As everyone know, what is an electromagnetic spectrum? It's nothing but you have an electric field in there, you have a magnetic field, and you can visualize the fields here. There are two colors here, red color and blue color. Okay, blue is representing your magnetic field and the red representing your electric field. Both are in perpendicular directions, right? So electromagnetic spectrum consists of an electric field which varies in magnitude in direction perpendicular to the direction in which the radiation is traveling, and the magnetic field oriented at right angles to the electric field, right? So both these fields travel at the speed of light. We all know what the speed of light, it's nothing but 3 into 10 power 8 meters per second. At the same speed, these two magnetic fields will actually move. It has a specific direction, it has a specific magnitude, right? So now let's go and understand what are the different wavelengths which are present inside. So you can see a small picture. So now if you are making a note of, or you are trying to make a note of something, from here I expect you to maintain a running notes. Okay, because if simply I show you these slides, I share these slides, nothing will go into your mind. From here we are going to talk about the numbers. You need to remember those numbers, the wavelength ranges, what are the names, because that is very important. When I say Landsat 1, you should quickly say which wavelengths are we using there. That should be the level of understanding and level of memory you should have. Okay, in order to understand those, first you should understand what are the wavelengths which are present in the electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, so you can see here, this is a quick review about the electromagnetic spectrum. You can see first is your radio waves and microwave, infrared, optical, ultraviolet, X-ray and gamma ray. And you can see a small window which is showing you your small spectrum, which is nothing but your visible range. Okay, visible range, you all know what are these colors, and our human eye is only sensitive to this radiation. Optical radiation only our human eyes can visualize. But what is your satellite sensors doing? The sensors which are doing in the satellite can visualize, some satellites can visualize your radio waves, some can visualize your microwaves, some can visualize infrared, some can visualize ultraviolet, X-ray and gamma ray. Okay, so that's your electromagnetic spectrum. So now you can see frequency, you know this formula, C is equal to V into lambda. Okay, so C is your speed of light, frequency, your wavelength, I hope you understand all these things. Where the shorter the wavelength, higher is the frequency, longer the wavelength, lower is the frequency. I am not discussing all these physics here. Okay, we'll go to the next slide. So now a quick review here, electromagnetic spectrum, right? So just focus on the slide very keenly. Okay, we will be going to talk about different wavelengths, different names of those wavelengths and their application at the bottom. Okay, so you can see on the x-axis is nothing but your wavelengths in meters. Okay, if you can see, I started on the left hand side with a larger wavelength and going to the right hand side with a lesser or shorter wavelength. Okay, so starting with a higher wavelength, what's the name referred to this wavelength? You can just come here. The name is written over here. You can just visualize this. Okay, so from 10 power 3 till your 10 power minus 1, it's called as your radio wave. Okay, next to that you have a microwave. Next to that you have an infrared. Next, a very small visible region. Visualize, out of this entire electromagnetic spectrum, a very small range, that too in nanometers, you can micrometers, you will visualize, our eyes will visualize. Next to that is your ultraviolet. Remember our ozone layer? So that's your ultraviolet. Next comes your x-rays. Next comes your gamma rays. Okay, so radio waves have higher wavelength, so obviously it is at a shorter frequency. Okay, so you can see that also here at the bottom x-axis, if you can see, that's the frequency which has been shown. Okay, so you can visualize here, what we are trying to show you is the size of the particle. Okay, so now if you see the radio waves size, you can see there is a kind of small house. Okay, bacteria, this is a baseball. Next is you have a cell here, bacteria, virus, water molecule. So just to make you interpret or imagine the size of the wavelength we are just talking. Okay, so you can see the bacteria, it's having a very small size, right? Bacteria will not be visible to our eyes. Virus also doesn't visible to our eyes. That's a small, how our naked eyes cannot visualize that bacteria. In the same way, your visible region or your ultraviolet region also will be very small range. Okay, and if you see the radio waves or your soccer field, if you just have a look on that, the visualization will be very high. If your eyes wanted to see the house, it's having a very the range or that length, whatever we visualize, that's little big. So that will be your radio wave. Okay, so the source which actually captures that radio wave is nothing but your, you know, these radio towers which will sit, no, they actually capture these radio waves, your FM radio, right? And when it comes to microwave region, it's been captured by your microwave oven, your radar, right? Next coming your infrared, and visible region is being captured by the bulbs or the people. Next coming x-rays, you know, an x-ray machine, whichever is there, no, that actually covers your hard part of the x-rays. Okay, and next coming your the other one is radioactive elements. Okay, so the radioactive elements, whatever are there, they also can capture those wavelength ranges. Okay, so this slide is basically talking you about different wavelength ranges. What are they actually trying to, showing you is the size of the wavelength. Okay, radio is having a very high wavelength. High, I mean the wavelength will be measured in meters. Okay, when it is coming to the microwave, it is just entering either the kind of micrometer or nanometer scale. Okay, next to that, if you just see this visible region, a very small region which actually looks like your bacteria or virus. Okay, so down, if you see step by step, first is your wavelength, it is showing in meters. Next, the size of the wavelength. If you wanted to just compare the size of that, the radio waves are having a very big size. And at the small, if you just come, water molecule, how it looks, a very small water molecule. Next, the name, the source, and this is the frequency. Okay, so this is the understanding. Now you can make a note of the ranges. So this is the range which we are going to see here is your, so if you have these wavelengths in your mind, that's it, your remote sensing becomes very easy to do. Okay, because when I refer the satellite, I download some data. Okay, then it says, okay, gamma ray wavelength range. So now you should go back, think what is the range, because you might be wondering why this range is important to me. Okay, because when a satellite, for example, I have shown you the Landsat 1, Landsat 2, so on up to Landsat 9. So each of the satellite has a wavelength range. Okay, so let's say my Landsat 1 has a wavelength range from infrared to, let's say, a kind of visible region. So it can only capture infrared and visible region. So that region is fixed to me. Now I should understand, in these ranges, which objects actually reflect this radiation? Because the satellite captures the reflected radiation. Again, in the reflected radiation also, this electromagnetic spectrum only will be there. Because in the incident energy, electromagnetic spectrum is there. Reflected also, electromagnetic spectrum will be there. Okay, so let's say this is my object. Okay, my object is this. When radiation is falling onto this, I say some transmission happens, some reflection happens. Let's say my body is reflecting infrared radiation. Out of all the spectrum which is falling onto that, it absorbed all the radiation, all wavelength radiation, but it is only reflecting infrared radiation. Okay? So if it's reflecting infrared radiation, what is captured by the satellite which is sitting there? It's only capturing infrared radiation. Right? So if infrared radiation is reaching to the satellite, so you should understand which object actually reflects your infrared radiation. Is it soil, or is it really a water body, or is it a built up area, or it is a road? So there are standard response curves. Okay, so each body, how it responds, there is a standard curve which makes you understand what's the reflection pattern. By seeing the reflection pattern from the satellite, you should be able to say what's the object which is sitting there. So in order to understand that, first I should know how many wavelength ranges are there in the electromagnetic spectrum, which is what is the range of each one of that. Then only I will be able to guess what can be the reflection pattern, right? So now let's see what are each kind of pattern here. So you can make a note over here. Radio waves, if you see, it's the bottom point is 1 meter. Okay. Next to that, from 1 meter to approximately 10^-3, you can see you have the range of microwave. From your 10^-3, your infrared starts till 1 micrometer. Okay. In between that, you have the visible range. Next to that, you have a ultraviolet. Next to that, your nanometer starts, which is your X-rays. And next to that, you have the gamma rays. Okay? So now you can make a note. 10^4 till 1 meter, it's radio wave. Next again, 1 meter to 10^-3, it's microwave. From 10^-3 till 10^6 approximately, it's infrared. Okay, and next you have a very small region of 10^-6 to 10^-7 micrometer, it's visible range. Next, from there, 10^-7 to 10^-9, it's ultraviolet. Okay, you can just have a look over here. 10^-9. Okay, so that's your ultraviolet. From there till 10^-11, it's X-rays. From 10^-11 to 10^-13, approximately, it's gamma rays. So radio waves, microwave, infrared, visible region, ultraviolet, X-ray, and gamma ray. Okay, so first thing you should understand is radio, micro. Actually, if you see the latest technology, so normally if you see the olden satellites or till date satellites, if you see at least till 2005 or 2010, if you see, most of the satellites are being designed, are being capturing the objects in infrared to this visible region or ultraviolet region, not ultraviolet, also visible region. Most of the satellites are being focusing only on this window of infrared and your visible region. The latest technology, if you see, they are there are some publications also which are working on microwave and radio waves also. Okay. Still, there is a research to be done on capturing of gamma rays through satellites. Okay. So you should focus mainly. I don't say that you don't remember the ranges of the other wavelength ranges, but you should have a basic idea about what is the wavelength range, and next you should have a clear understanding about what is happening in between this infrared to your ultraviolet ray. Okay, so now you can see the ultraviolet or UV portion of the spectrum has the shortest wavelength. The radiation is just beyond the violet portion of the visible wavelengths, hence it names as ultraviolet. Why the name itself is called as UV radiation or ultraviolet is nothing but because it's just the end of the, remember the VIBGR, the, what do you say, the rainbow colors? So, after your violet ends, from there, your ultraviolet starts. Some earth surface materials, primarily rock and minerals, fluorescence or emit visible light when illuminated by UV radiation. So, these actually respond for the UV radiation, okay? So, this part, we will talk in the next class, which is a detailed understanding about our visible spectrum. So remember, the visible spectrum is nothing but the kind of radiation which our human eyes are very, what do you say, very sensitive, or they can only visualize this your visible region, okay? And you can understand how small it is. It's only from 0.7 micrometer to 0.4 micrometer, very, very small region our human eyes can detect, okay? So we will see here what are the colors in that, what is the wavelength range of that, in the next coming classes also I will pose a question to you, why sun, actually the sunrise, if you see why it's in orange color, and why the sky actually looks blue in color. So all these answers you will get one by one.
So we will stop our discussion here. We'll see you again in the next lecture. Thank you for your attention.